It's a great pleasure to welcome Marika Brancese to give one of our seminars today. Marika is originally from Italy. She did her PhD in Bologna, working on things which are not related to gravitational waves, not related to multi-messenger astrophysics. But then she made the switch, and during her postdocs in Europe, she switched into gravitational wave astrophysics and has become a real star in this field. And this star really started to shine, or I should say explode, with GW170817, which was such a gift to this community and to all of astronomy. Most recorded astronomical event in human history, the most observed astronomical event in human history. Anyway, so I'm looking at Marika's six-page CV full of various awards and the important things that she's doing. So she's currently a full professor in astronomy and astrophysics at GSSI. She's also chairing the Einstein Telescope Observation Science Board, which is, a really new exciting direction in this field. We all hope that Einstein Telescope succeeds. She's a member of the Einstein Telescope Steering Committee, and she's also a member of the Virgo Steering Committee. She's a coordinator of the Working Group of Synergies with Future Facilities for THESEUS, she has done other really, key things in the past. I hope that, so I'm not going to list all of her awards and stuff like this. So recently she got the Occhialini Prize for her vision and bridging the observational astronomy and experimental gravitational wave physics. Anticipated the majestic discovery of GW170817 when a flash of multicolor light was emitted concurrently with a long surge gravitational wave signal, and many other impressive awards. Okay, so without further ado, why don't I hand over to Marika and hear something about the multi-messenger astrophysics science.
So thank you very much for the presentation and to invite me here. And so what I will do is an overview of what is the status of multi-messenger astronomy. And today, multi-messenger astronomy for me is more gravitational wave and electromagnetic emission. And then what for me will be the next year, but also what will be the future, so 10 years from now. And so I start with the past. And first of all, what are the fantastic instruments that we have today and that enable us to make gravitational wave astronomy? Here you can see the two LIGO antenna and Virgo, and now we have also Kagra that joined the last run. These detectors are currently not observing the sky because they are in a phase of an upgrade, and they will start again to observe the sky next year. So far we had three rounds of observation, and very quickly I want to show you a few results, but mainly what was the impact on astrophysics of this detector. And in this three rounds, we had the increase of sensitivity. Since we are searching for very rare events, increasing the sensitivity means increasing the volume and so the chance of detecting event. And we already see this a lot in 102 and 03. So far, we detected binaries of compact object, but in the band of LIGO, Virgo, and Kagra, we can observe also, for example, core collapse of massive star, cosmic strings, so burst event, neutron star instability, like a star quake in a neutron star that are associated, for example, with magnetars. And we can detect also continuous wave. And also there is the possibility to detect stochastic background on the basis of the rate that we today observe of binary compact object. We expect that we will detect before an astrophysical background and possibly a cosmological background. So far we detected only binaries of compact object, binaries of black holes, neutron star and neutron star black hole. I go to the first run. The first run was really spectacular because we had this fantastic signal. The first one was so loud, it was also evident in the raw data. This signal told us that a binary system exists, that they can merge in the Hubble time. And what was a surprise that had a big impact on the knowledge of the evolution of massive star was the mass of this binary system. So the mass of the two black hole of the component black hole was around 30 solar masses. And so this had a big impact on understanding the formation of this big black hole. Then we have the second run, we arrived to 11 signal. So we had the 10 other 10 detection of binary black hole, but what was spectacular was the detection of the binary neutron star that started the most extensive observational campaign in the human being with observation in all the band, and also today there are observation in the galaxy where this binary system merged, this binary system of neutron star merge. This is the last run, so we arrived to 90 gravitational wave events. So this means that we started with a few events, also without knowing about the existence, for example, of binary black hole, stellar mass binary black hole. And today we have 90 events. So the majority of them are binary black hole. And we can start to make something that was impossible a few years ago, so population studies. And so now we know better the distribution of mass of the black hole. We know better the rate, the local rate so far, because we are limited by our detector to a relative local universe with respect to other detector, but this really was impossible before gravitational waves. And so since today the topic is electromagnetic emission and gravitational waves, I have to make again a summary. I think that you listen this many times, but maybe is all the time interesting to look again at what happened for GV170817. And we detected the gravitational wave signal. And from the gravitational wave signal, I have to say that the most important parameter that we can measure directly is the mass. So the component mass is something that was incredibly important to understand better the stellar mass black hole. But also in these cases, the mass told immediately to us that we were in front of sources with the same mass of the neutron star that we know in our galaxy. And then another very important parameter is the tidal deformability. This is very, very important also for the electromagnetic emission because it's directly connected to the amount of mass that can give rise to the electromagnetic emission. And in particular, from the gravitational wave signal, we can, looking at the tidal deformability, also put constraint on the equation of state of the neutron star. So we have this way to really look at the nature of neutron star. And in this plot, you can see the tidal deformability of the two component of the binary system. You see that the most probable region is around zero. So this zero means that we cannot exclude from a gravitational wave side also the presence of a black hole. And here in the white is the less probable. The line corresponds to different equation of state. So from the gravitational wave signal, we can say that we can exclude the most hard equation of state. And I will show later, I think that I have not a plot, but from the electromagnetic side, we can exclude the softer equation of state. And then there was the detection from Fermi GBM, and almost immediately also the detection of integral, so a gamma ray burst there. From the point of view, okay, I have a bar over the plot, but from the point of view of the GRB, this GRB, from an observational point of view, was exactly what we classify as a short gamma ray burst. The energy, the time. But if you look to the energetic of this object, we can see immediately that this object is fainter with respect to all the GRB observed before. So the people start to ask themselves, so we are looking something off axis for the first time, or this is something intrinsically fainter. So what we expect when we see a jet of axis? So we have the jet interact in the interstellar medium and decelerate, and this accelerate, we have a decrease of the Lorentz factor. So what happens is that we have an increase of the relativistic beaming, and so the emitting surface increase, and so also an observer that is off axis can observe the emission from a gamma ray burst. And this was one of the first papers that came out with the press release of these events. I think that this comes from Troy et al, 2017. And here you can see that after 9 days, there was a detection of an X-ray, and after 16 days, a detection in the radio band. And if you look here, these curves correspond exactly to an off-axis GRB, while in an on-axis GRB had a different shape in the light curves. So the people start to say, okay, we are observing for the first time an off-axis GRB. And the expectation was a decline in the emission. But then what was observed for many, many months was an increase in all the band of the flux. And in reality, this can be explained in two ways. So a jet observed off axis, but a structured jet. So a jet in which we have a angular distribution of the velocity, but can be explained also thinking about a mildly relativistic isotropic outflow. In this case, we have a radial distribution of the velocity. And from the light curves, it is impossible to distinguish among these two scenarios. And what helped us to understand if there was a jet or not was radio observation. Because radio observation gives us the resolution to look at the source and also to measure the size of the source. And the size of the source was is inconsistent with the mildly relativistic outflow. And in particular, the size is smaller than what you expect for a mildly relativistic outflow. And so this was really the probe that told us, okay, there was a jet for sure and was a structured jet. So all the observation of the non-thermal emission are consistent with this scenario of the jet. If we talk about the X-ray, the radio and the optical observation, not the initial optical observation because it was dominated by the kilonova, but later. And the only emission in which there is not consensus on the community on if it was due to the jet or more a shock breakout emission is the initial gamma ray burst. So the initial gamma ray burst is not still clear if it was the jet, the structured jet, or really a shock breakout related also to the kilonova ejecta. So if we go to the non-thermal emission, also here there was a lot of observation in all the bands, a really rich amount of data. And in the movie, you can see also the fantastic spectra that we took with the VLTX shooter. And so this is the emission from the kilonova. And what was observed was very similar to what was predicted before. So the presence of a blue emission at the beginning and a red emission later. These are due to different components of the ejecta. So the blue component is due to a component in which we have more weak interaction. So we have not the formation of very heavy elements. We have a less opacity. And so we have this blue component. And then we have a slower component that is the red one in which we have the features of a process nucleosynthesis in which we have the presence of very heavy elements. So we have a lot of data. The picture was also what we predicted before, where theoreticians predicted before. But understanding the spectra is something that is still very difficult. and also the evolution of the spectra in 10 days. So it's not like in the supernovae in which you have a narrow line, which you say, okay, I form this element and these other elements. Here you are in front of different components that are superrelativistic, but around 0.4, 0.5 speed of light. We have very heavy elements for which we don't know all the atomic levels of these lines. So we have very broad lines, a lot of lines mixed together. So it's really very difficult to identify what elements form there. But we have the brightness, we have the evolution. So in some sense, we can say the amount of heavy elements that form there. And on the basis of the rate today and on the basis of the brightness, and so the amount that we can estimate of these elements, we can say that the binary system of neutron stars are one of the major channels of formation of heavy elements. There are, I think, now a solid observation that is the presence of strontium. So this is something that I think is pretty solid. It's not a very heavy element. It's not the Latanides, typical Latanides, so this is lighter. But its presence is solid in this spectrum. So from an observational point of view, we can say that this feature is solid. We can see the features, the absorption features of the strontium. And there are also work now that start from numerical relativity and go up to the nucleosynthesis and the emission of the kilonova, that starting from the properties of the progenitor of GV17087 are able to obtain the same amount of strontium that is necessary to reproduce the spectra. And so this is the status of the things. And I think that there are a lot to learn from the spectra and a lot of things to do to create also synthetic spectra that help us to understand the spectra of the kilonova. And important things that we lose completely the first 11 hours. And so also there are components that can be very, very interesting to understand the ejecta in the kilonova emission. So GV170817, to make a summary, was, I think, incredibly important to understand the relativistic jet. And in particular, this was the first strong evidence of a structured jet. Tell us something about the nucleosynthesis in the universe and show us this new way to try to understand the equation of state of neutron star. Another important thing was cosmology. So we have big error now when we estimate the Hubble constant with gravitational waves. But from the gravitational waves, we can estimate the distance. And if we have also the distance from the host galaxy, we can estimate the Hubble constant. As I told before, now we have big error. We have error on the distance that are mainly due to the degeneracy between the orbital plane and the distance. And we need a lot of joint detection really to make cosmology at the level of supernovae or CMB. But this is totally new way. So can say really something in the tension between CMB and supernovae. And there are also methods that don't use the electromagnetic counterpart. Another thing is that for this object was very close, 40 megaparsecs, so it was also possible to study the details of the galaxy, and so also to see if there was globular cluster or not, the position in the galaxy, the population of the galaxy, and so was also something very important to understand better compact object formation and evolution. So after GV170817, there are many questions open. So is GV170817 and its electromagnetic emission typical for all binary neutron stars? What happens when we see this system in different angles? What happens when we have a neutron star black hole? What was the merger remnant? So from the gravitational wave point of view, we are not able to, with the instrument that we have today, we are not able to detect the signal post-merger. So we really don't know from that side if there was a black hole or neutron star. We have some hint from the electromagnetic emission, very, very likely was not a direct collapse in a black hole. Probably there was a formation of an unstable neutron star that then collapsed in a black hole. And then also about heavy elements, it's the only way to produce heavy elements or not, what happened along the cosmic history. Was the GRB due to the jet or a shock breakout? What is the nature of neutron star? And in the end, what is the physics that governs these extreme events? So many, many years of GRB, and we have also now a lot of surprise, and we don't know well many, many things of GRB. And gravitational wave can help to understand these extreme events. So what happened after GV170817? So from the point of view of gravitational wave detection, we had another binary neutron star. We had other events very interesting in which we have neutron star black hole, but we didn't have any electromagnetic counterpart. So the reason where is, so one, we are, LIGO and Virgo are observing larger volume of the universe, so we are searching for fainter event. The sky localization was not good in many of these events. And so this means that the search is very challenging. And then we had also system in which we don't expect electromagnetic emission. For example, the neutron star black hole that we detected, the mass ratio was large, and so the what we expect is that the neutron star fall down in the black hole without being disrupted, and so there were different things for which we were not able to detect an electromagnetic counterpart. Also, the rates are not extremely high. So one thing that I want to say that there was an indication of a weak emission, but there is no consensus on this counterpart, but this is a very interesting event. So there was, we observed the birth of an intermediate massive black hole. We observed the merger of two black hole, very massive. They are in the mass gap where we don't expect a black hole from stars. But these are probably black hole that comes from the merger of others black hole. So these are hierarchical, they come from hierarchical merger, or they can come from stellar merger in your cluster. But these events can be explained also with another scenario, that this binary system of black holes forms and evolve in the active galactic nuclei disk, so around an AGN. In this case, you have a situation in which you increase the possibility to have high mass black hole binary, again through the merger of previous black hole. In this scenario, so when you have a binary system of black hole in a AGN disk, you have an environment that is more dense, and you can expect an electromagnetic emission. So there was a detection of ZTF in the optical band, and in particular, this was detected 34 days after the G event, was consistent with the expectation for a merger in AGN disk, but the sky localization of the G event was huge. So the association is not so easy. And so I have to say that the community is not totally convinced that this was a counterpart. I think that we need to detect more of these events to say something about this, but it's a very interesting scenario. Then after O3, so after O3, there was also some people that start to say, okay, so at this point, maybe that we are in front of something similar to the supernovae 1987, in which for many, many years, we are waiting for a new event. But in reality, also without gravitational waves, there are surprises. And one of these surprises was these events. So these events happen last year before Christmas. And in particular, this is an event that you classify as long gamma ray burst. And so the duration of the gamma ray burst is a minute. You have a prompt and bright spikes that if it doesn't arrive to 1 minute, at least the bright spike is more than 12 seconds. So what you classify as long. And also from the point of view of the hardness. And this GRB was relatively closely, 350 megaparsec. And the surprise was that this GRB show a kilon of emission. And so the people that analyze these events, so that is surprising, so a long GRB that is due to a binary system. So looking at these events and looking also at the population of GRB around us, we can say that probably the 10% of local long gamma ray burst arise from mergers. And this is very interesting because increase our chance of detection of a GRB with the gravitational waves. And another important thing is if this event would have been happen next year, so when the LIGO and Virgo will be observed, these events would have been detected with an SNR around 7. So this event would have been detected. So this means that the GV170817 events are not so unlikely. So they are there, and so this is very promising for the next years. Another discovery, and this interests more GSSI group. So what we discover here was also something very interesting. So we discover a GEV emission. And so what there is there is an emission in the band 0.11 GeV. We made this detection in the data of Fermilat. And in particular, you can see here that is a late emission that is almost flat at the beginning and then disappears. So there are other GRB that show a GeV emission, but typically this GeV emission is declining and is typically close also to the merger. So here is all our modeling of all the data. This GRB was observed in X-ray radio and so radio upper limit, but X-ray and optical band. So these you can see are all our modeling of all these very rich set of data, in which we have the classical afterglow due to the forward shock plus the kilonova. And here you can see the GEV detection. In this plot, you can see the set of this emission. And you can see that in the spectra, you can see the spectral evolution because these different color correspond to different time in the light curves. And what you can see here is that the first detection is compatible still with the forward shock. But if you look to the second detection, that in this plot is the red one, is no more consistent with the forward shock. So we are in front of an excess with respect to the synchrotron emission from the standard forward shock. And we try to understand where this emission can come from. And this emission is can be explained through external inverse Compton. And in particular, the kilonova can be the sixth photon for the external inverse Compton. And the electron are not the electron of the ultra-relativistic jet, but we need to invoke the presence of a late time low power jet that is used also to explain other properties in other GRBs. And this is very interesting. And I can show you that with this component, we are able to explain the excess. And this is very interesting because first of all, this is a new counterpart. So this was not detected in GV170817 because in our interpretation of these events, GV170817 was observed off axis. And so this is a new counterpart to search for also in the next gravitational wave events, so binary system of neutron star. And this is very interesting because this can be another way to try to understand the interaction between the central engine and the kilonova ejecta. And so I think this is very promising. So next observing grants, what will happen? So what we expect is that LIGO in Virgo and CAGRA will start observation next year. We will have an increase of the volume of that this observatory will look at. And so we will have an increase of binary intrastar detection. We expect 5 to 10, more likely I think 5. And I think that is promising, and we need really to look for an electromagnetic counterpart that can be so spectacular as GV17017. There are a lot of news in the coming years. First of all, from the point of view of the gravitational wave network. So in the next years, we expect that CAGRA will increase its sensitivity, not in O4. In O4, we don't expect CAGRA very sensitive, but in O5, yes. And then at the end of this, so around the 30, we expect also LIGO India. Improving the network, the network means improving in the sky localization capability. And this is very, very important because you can search in a smaller region and you can go very deep with the electromagnetic observatories. We expect neutrino detection, so IceCube and Kilometer3Net in Europe. We have really also very interesting new observatory, new and old in this plot because I show so far, but we expect new observatory like the Vera Rubin Observatory, I think will be great. In Europe, we will have instruments similar to VLTX shooter for the spectroscopy called SOX, SKA. We will have ELT at some point. James Webb Telescope will be great for kilon of emission. Nancy Roman, Euclid. Oh, Euclid can give also really the large scale structure, it can give a lot of redshift for many galaxies and can be very, very useful for also making cosmology also with gravitational waves. Then we have also wide field in the X-ray, like ISAM probe. We will have, we have already JECAM, again, a wide field in the gamma ray, a wide field in the UV, again, very, very important for the kilon of emission. We will start to have also cube satellite in the X-ray gamma, and then we will have CTA. So I think that the future is in the next swarm too, in the next years is really very bright from this point of view, because we will have also instruments on the electromagnetic side that are really more sensitive and also able to monitor very large sky area. And now I go to the next generation, and this is mostly the work on, my work is mainly on this now. And what will be the future? And they start with the European concept. So in Europe, we are working for the building of ET and Einstein telescope. The design is to have a triangular shape instrument with arms of 10 kilometers underground, cryogenic, xylophone concept, in which we have in each arms a low frequency interferometer and high frequency interferometer. So what is very important is that ET was included in the priority of Europe. We have this S3 roadmap, so it's one of the priority of Europe now. United States, we have a different concept that is Cosmic Explorer. Cosmic Explorer is a surface detector, very similar from the concept to LIGO, is much, much, much larger, so 40 kilometer detector. And in particular, what you can see here is the improvement in sensitivity with respect to LIGO, Virgo, and CAGRA, best sensitivity of O5. And what you can see here for it is that we have an improvement in the sensitivity in all the band of a factor 10, but we start to explore really low frequencies. So we start to explore a totally new band for frequency with, we want at least to go at lower frequency. what this means. So first of all, going to lower frequency means to explore the early universe. So when we observe a binary black hole, the mass is reshifted. So also if we want to observe black hole like the one that we observe today, we need to go to low frequency. And thanks also to this low frequency, we can really reach the dark ages with our observation. And we really can talk about the population studies along the cosmic history. And to give you some number that we obtained recently using a Fisher matrix approximation. So all the things that I will say you also about parameter estimation are now obtained not with the real parameter estimation, so with not with Bayesian approach, but with the Fisher matrix. What we did was to take population of binary black hole and population of binary neutron star consistent with what we observed today. And we look at the detection efficiency of the Einstein telescope. And in particular for binary neutron star, we will detect 10 to the 5 binary neutron star per year. And for binary black hole, and these are binary black hole with the mass that we are observing today, so there are not in this plot intermediate massive black hole, we will detect almost all of them. So again, 10 to the 5 binary black hole per year. So this means that we will have an enormous amount of trigger and that we will have really a fantastic way to study compact object along the cosmic history. Another important thing is that for the first time we can make precise gravitational wave astronomy, because if we stay in the more local universe, we can increase a lot the parameter estimation. So all the work that for which are very important, the parameter estimation, can be done in a precise way. One of these, for example, is the study related to the equation of state of the neutron star. Here, for example, is a prediction for detecting the signal of the remnant after the merger. And so in this case, up to 100 megaparsec, also a bit more, we can detect the signal from the merger remnant. That is extremely interesting because, again, this is strongly related to the equation state. And the low frequency will make it possible to explore very high mass. And so in this plot, you can see the mass that we will be able to explore. In reality, to do this plot, we didn't use the higher order mode. So I have new simulation in which you can see that in reality is also higher. So we can reach also higher higher redshift for more massive black hole. So we can detect black hole up to 10 to the 3, really with arriving also to very large redshift. And this is very interesting because if Einstein Telescope and Cosmic Explorer will observe the sky with LISA, we will have a way to understand if massive black hole are related, and then also supermassive black hole are related to stellar mass black hole, and if stellar mass black hole are the seeds of massive black hole. Another things that we can do, and I think is really very interesting, are the detection of primordial black hole. We expect an increase of the density of primordial black hole going to large redshift. And in particular, we expect to arrive to redshift in which we can say that the black hole don't come from pop 3 star. In reality, the James Webb Telescope observation now are saying us that we have galaxy at very, very high redshift. So I think that we will have a lot of benefits for this type of study with the observation that the James Webb Telescope will do now, but to detect black holes at very, very high redshift, we really need the gravitational waves. And for cosmology, I think that the future, so I really think that to be at the same level of supernova and CMB, the current detector are not enough. I think that we need to wait the next generation. And with the next generation, I will show you the number of joint detection per year. And also using only the gravitational waves, we can make a cosmology with incredible results. For example, using the mass function of neutron star, or for example, using also binary black holes and large scale structure probe. And in particular, if we are able to go to a large redshift, we can also estimate not only the Hubble constant, but also other cosmological parameters. And we can test also modified gravitational wave propagation. And in particular, for this modified gravity model, we expect that distance that we measure, the distance luminosity that we measure with the electromagnetic side is different with distance luminosity that we measure with the gravitational waves. So having a GRB in which we can say this GRB is for sure associated to a gravitational waves, and then the GRB, the host galaxy of the GRB, give us a luminosity distance that is different with respect to the luminosity distance from the gravitational wave side, could be striking to test modified gravity at cosmological scale. Okay, I go to the multi-messenger, and here I have to say that all these science cases, so kilonova and equation of state constraint, nucleosynthesis, probe, the GRB engine, understand the roles of BNS and neutron star black hole, understand how many binary neutron star emit and produce a jet, and link all this process to the star formation, to the metallicity evolution of the universe. All this work will benefit a lot from the fact that we will detect a lot of events up to a high redshift. And again, for the closer event, we will benefit about the better parameter estimation of the gravitational wave side. We have also a higher chance to detect other very interesting and promising multi-messenger sources like core collapse supernovae, also newborn neutron stars, also gravitational wave from magnetars, maybe also something related to fast radio burst and neutrinos. When we talk about multi-messenger, the first thing that is important is sky localization. So ET alone can localize binary neutron star. And in this plot, you can see the sky localization capability for ET alone. And why ET is able to localize? It's able to localize because you can use the low frequency, and you can localize the source using the Earth rotation. And so the modulation that we have in the amplitude related to the Earth rotation. And in particular, all the events that are also well localized can be also detected pre-merger. And this is very interesting because we can give early warning. And in particular, we can have about 100 detection per year with sky localization less than 100 square degrees. And this is very good if you think that this is a single detector. But if you are your detector in a network of detector, clearly the situation improves a lot, and we can have 1,000 detection with sky localization less than 10 square degrees if we have one cosmic explorer in the United States observing with ET. And with the two cosmic explorers, one in the United States and one in Australia, we can arrive to 1,000 detection per year with the sky localization less than one square degree. So the future will be very different with respect to today, because up to a certain redshift that is around 0.4, we will be able to detect kilonova. The thermal emission is intrinsically fainter with respect to a gamma ray burst. So take into account that we will have sky localization that are relatively large with respect to the electromagnetic observatory. So we have some events with sky localization less than one square degree, but we don't have something around arc mean or arc second that enable us to point an instrument, directly pointing an instrument like ELT. So we will need a large field of view. So taking into account these and the brightness of the kilonova, we will be able to detect the kilonova, as I said, up to 0.4. But if we want a counterpart at larger redshift, we really need high energy. There is no other way. And so here we will have gamma ray bursts. Here we will benefit of the fact that increasing the volume differently from now, which we don't expect in the LIGO and Virgo volume a large number. We have a very small number of events that point to us. So that has the jet pointing to us. In the future, we will have a sample of GRB pointing with us, in which we will have also the gravitational wave emission. And I show you some estimates that we did, and in particular for the thermal emission for the kilonova, we look at the Vera Rubin Observatory, not in survey mode, but we look at strategy based on target of opportunity, three epochs of observation of 600 seconds. And what we obtain is about 40 joint detection per year, with about 10% of the Vera Rubin telescope time. And looking at the Hubble constant, this means that we can go in principle to sub percent precision. Then we did a very comprehensive study. This was driven by Samuele Ronchini, that is one of my PhD. And this is a work on the gamma ray burst and the expectation of having a gravitational wave detection. In particular, we look at the prompt and afterglow emission, and we model the prompt and afterglow emission taking into account of a structured jet. And for the afterglow, we use also the forward shock, but also the high latitude emission. And in particular, what we did was to take a binary neutron star population and to make a Monte Carlo and make this population able to reproduce all the observation of short GRB by Fermi. So then all the properties that we are observing for the GRB, but also the number of GRB that we are observing. And then starting from this, we make prediction for different satellites. In this plot, you can see Fermi GBM, and in particular, what is interesting is you can see here the gravitational wave detection. In green, you can see the gamma ray detection by Fermi, and in red, the joint detection. So what you can see in this plot is that almost all detected short GRB in the future will have a gravitational wave counterpart. That is very impressive. So every GRB will be a multi-messenger source with multi-messenger observation. Depending on the satellite, we will have tens to hundreds of detections. And clearly here is crucial also to understand what we have different type of instruments. Some of them, I show you the prediction, some of them detect a huge number. So if you take, for example, JCAM, we have hundreds of detection. And on the other side, we have instruments like TZEUS in which we have 10 detection, but they are different. So while JCAM can be useful for population study, instruments like TZEUS are very, very important because are the one that give the sky localization to drive the follow-up by ground to make so the source similar to GV170817 to have a redshift, and so to really understand and characterize the source. For what concerns the afterglow, we analyzed two strategies, survey mode and pointing mode, and you can see here that the number can increase of tens of detection using looking at the X-ray. And we look also the pointing mode also here when you have a network of detector, you can arrive also to hundreds of detection. But here you need to be extremely fast. So you need to be on source really within 1 hour. And another big issue is the number, because if you look at the sources that you have to follow up, for example, in our simulation, we follow up all the sources with a sky localization less than 100 square degree. And the number is really huge when you have network of detectors. So what will be incredibly important in the future will be the selection, the prioritization of the events to be followed up. And in this, I think it will be very important that the gravitational wave community will give other information like viewing angle or other information on the source that enable to make a selection of the events to be followed up. The X-ray is very important because enable us to observe in this plot, in this histogram, you see the object, the source is observed off axis and on axis. So in orange are the on axis and in gray, the slightly off axis that you can observe with the X-ray, the wide field monitors in X-ray like TESIUS. And so you can see that you have an increase more in the low redshift side, but you have a big increase of event of axis. And it is very, very important also to understand the structure of the jet. And now the last part, if I have a bit of other minutes, I will give you some information on synergy of the gravitational wave detector and instrument like CTA, so instrument in the very high energy. So all this work, I think, are very, very interesting because we already observed the GRB in the very high energy. And we had also this fantastic, incredible detection of a GRB that was detected, as Felix told us, with a very significant detection of LASO, and was detected also in Fermilat. So we really have an amazing source that are stimulating really a lot this field of gamma ray bursts in very high energy. And in particular, what we did was to make a simulation to understand if there are chances to detect the very high energy prompt emission from binary neutron star. And we find that there is a way that we think are promising. That means using the early warning alerts from the gravitational wave detector to try to detect the very high energy prompt emission. So what we did was to make a lot of simulation in which we try to understand what is the sky localization capability of a T or a T plus Cosmic Explorer before the merger. And here you can see the number. These are system with all the orientation. Clearly, we expect a very high energy emission from a jet, so from an on-axis event. So if we look to the on-axis events, the number of detection decrease, but are still not small in the cases of a network. So we need really a network of 3G detector. Here in this number, we need to take into account the duty cycle of CTA. So this number decreased because we have a 15% duty cycle. And but we explore a strategy that we think can be very promising, that is try to follow up all the events, and you make only one observation at the time of the merger. And what we obtained was we did simulation for, I don't go in details, but we did simulation for the medium-sized telescope, the large size telescope, and we did also different configuration using update from the gravitational wave sites. And at the end, we can have a few tenths of very high energy counterpart can be detected using 10% of CTA time. And we think that this is very, very promising for the future. And this is my last slide, which I think that we will have a revolution of the knowledge of the early universe in the next year. And in particular, the gravitational waves are also a unique wave to arrive there. And also all these instruments that are in this slide, I think will give us a lot of surprise in multi-messenger astronomy. And I have to thank all the group of GSSI, PhD and postdoc are here in this slide, because many of these work that I presented today comes from their work. I apologize if I took too much time.
Okay, thanks very much, Marika. There's so much stuff in this talk. Are there any questions from the audience? Please just speak. You don't have to raise your hand. Just unmute yourself and speak.
No, I was talking. I have a question about GRB 2121A. It's a very nice talk, by the way. The kilonova was relatively underluminous as a GRB, the one in 2017. So this one, you call it a long GRB, it must be much more luminous. So a kilonova can only have so much energy because it's a neutron star. For the emission, so can you explain the emission at such a large distance? Is the kilonova component very faint and you're just seeing the jet most of the time? How does the energetics work out compared to GRB 2017 and the 2021?
Okay. So the energetic is compatible with the, I go back to the plot in which, okay, this one. So the energetic is compatible with the GV170817, taking into account that was more distant with respect to GV170817. And clearly also in our modeling, we use both the components. So here you have kilonova emission plus the afterglow emission, and at least the kilonova emission start to be dominant in the infrared at late time. But okay. If you use only the afterglow, you are not able to explain. So if you take only the afterglow without the kilonova component, you are not able to explain all the optical observation there. So you need the kilonova component, and that consistent with the GV170817, but at larger distance.
Okay, great. Yeah, thanks.
Marika, is there any explanation for why a merger of neutron stars would give you a long GRB?
So yeah, I think it's also the classification. So many people say that this classification that we did with long and short gamma ray burst is not totally correct. So is a contamination of, so we need to try to understand if all the things that we use from an observational point of view to classify GRB are completely correct. So the picture is that one, the long typically are corresponding to core collapse also because we see supernovae, but there are contamination of one population with respect to the other. Then why in some cases longer with respect to other in which is shorter? I think this is not really clear, and we need really to explore this and try to understand. And in this also gravitational waves can help to understand why you can have this difference in the duration. But what is clear is this was also said, so there are also a lot of work previous to this one that were saying that there is contamination of short in the population of long and vice versa.
Sorry, can you explain how gravitational waves would help to settle this?
Yeah, because gravitational waves, at some point we will have observation of an example similar to this. So for example, in this case, we see the kilonova, but things in a case in which we will not be able to see kilonova because it's faint with respect to the afterglow, and there you have the gravitational wave signal, or vice versa is, I think this more for the future, because as I said before, the probability to have an on-axis GRB and the gravitational wave with the current detector is not so high. I think that the prediction for 04 is less than one. And 405 one, but so the number are small, but in the future this can help, and I think can really be important also for the neutron star black hole side, because also there the gravitational waves would be really very important to say us something. And I think also to relate to the progenitor, so we can have information on the mass of the progenitor, on the fact if the progenitor the mass ratio for example is different. So I think when we will have big sample, this can, so the gravitational wave sensors can clarify also if there are something that are related to the ejected mass, the mass that goes in the accretion disk and so on.
Thank you. Felix has a question.
Yeah, Marika, very nice talk. It's a pity that not so many people are attending. Just the question is just there are two other meetings. Even the is a bad for them actually that was missing this kind of talk.
Definitely.
And attending just a bit more routine stuff. Anyway, so I have one maybe a bit provocative question. Is you know, this Lhasa I mentioned, this detection, which is the case when I mean, theorists would say it experiment is wrong, cannot be that we could detect this, but on the other hand, experiment is very high significance, statistical significance, so it's not wrong. So there are different options, and all of them could have impact on these studies, at least in the multi-wavelength context. The one of them, I mean, there are axions, there are just Lorentz invariance violation, etc. But one of them is, I mean, more straightforward. Even there are no cosmologists here. I can say that otherwise they kill me. That this is not a cosmological distance, in the sense I remember the Barbich had a paper some 20 years ago when he has always some very specific views on many things. He was a great astronomer, of course, and he was thinking that at least part of GRBs are not at the cosmological distances, but could be nearby, like ejection of kind of objects, which, could it, assuming that the physics of GRBs is the same, but I mean, the merger or was, but they are not cosmological distances. Could it change somehow predictions related to the number of detection events or et cetera? Because I understand this, there's a severe horizon for detection or gravitational. I mean, if we connect to GRBs and they are nearby, then maybe it could be many of them. So, well, it's not a question, actually. Do we know people are talking about these kind of things or not? Because I think after this multi-TV detection, Lhasa, things cannot be taken as before.
The things are changing. Yeah. So saying that they are nearby, I think, is difficult because you have... at least a lot of them, you have identification of the galaxy, you have redshift. For the long, you have also redshift from the transient itself. So in some cases, it's that many of them have no galaxy, so maybe they could be more close than we expected. But for the one in which you have really the host galaxy, you have the redshift of... from, and mainly for the long GRB, you have also the redshift from the GRB itself. So they are at cosmological distance, at least a fraction of them. Then if you have a larger fraction close, clearly change the number of joint detection that you can have with the gravitational waves. And but on the basis of, so for example, for the rate of gravitational waves, I think that there now we have constraint from the gravitational wave itself, very big, because we have you go from almost 10 to more than 1,000 gigaparsec cube per year, so it's big, but you have constraint on that one. The thing is that we don't know what is the fraction of GRB that are of BNS that are producing a jet. And so changing the population of GRB and saying, okay, we have a lot of objects that are closer to us that we, for some reason, classify as distant, this can change, I think, mainly the fraction of BNS that are emitting, that are producing a jet, and can change the, in any case, a bit of the number of joint detection. So you make some assumption that they are distant and they are not close. Yeah.
And Marika, do you understand you correctly when you said that the redshift has been detected also from the just the transient itself?
Yeah, I mean, yeah, there are many cases. Long for the GRB, this is really very difficult because it's a faint remission. And but for the long, yes, for the long, you have different cases in which you have host galaxy, but also you have the redshift directly from the features that you have in the afterglow.
Yes, obviously they coincide.
I cannot say you what is the fraction. I have not in my mind, but there are many cases of
long. Also, Felix, don't you expect if the GRBs were more local, local sources are not expected to be isotropic in the sky, given the numbers that are now being detected?
No, I know all the arguments.
We would see any signature of any population which is local. This would be immediately apparent, right?
So there is reality, also if you look Fermi, there is a detection for which we don't have the redshift that are weak, and there are people that are thinking that are more local, but
yeah, it has to be a small fraction.
Yeah.
I mean, some magnetars could be GRBs, but
yes.
Yeah.
I think that God is talking, but exciting. I don't see. We are not listening to you, Gor. Your voice.
Yeah, I have a problem. I think internet is is oscillating. So bet I stop. I don't ask questions.
No, I'm listening you very, very well, Felix. I don't know the other. I see
it's only coming and going. That is very funny. Yeah. I mean, but anyway, so I think what you said, yes, I understand how it's difficult to claim non-local. Nevertheless, it's even more exciting than what is then all this stuff, because it's really amazing.
Yeah, for sure, it changed a lot the picture around GRB, and it will have a big impact in all these type of studies. I don't know if Gor.
Yeah, no, I just wanted to add one more argument to Felix. Maybe it's not a convincing argument, is the fact of the afterglow, because if it was a galactic source, I mean, we see a very standard afterglow, which requires the source to be ultra-relativistic, and the models when gamma ray bursts are galactic or nearby objects, this probably would contradict the observed afterglow. This is one argument, and there is another.
No, I agree. I know all these arguments.
I am sure that you know.
All the world was attacking garbage, but nevertheless, you know, it's we also trust gamma-gamma interactions.
Yes. Yeah. So, but there are some interesting ideas how to have this.
I know ideas, but ideas also were known before. It's just two, actually, axions, and then the Lorentz invariance violation.
Oh, but that even okay.
But anyway, not to deviate from the
main. Yes, yes.
It is. Yeah. And Marika, another thing is just again the question about this connection with ground-based instruments. The you are talking about this CTA, which is a great, but it seems they will be also interesting, this LHASO low energy instrument, also future these southern hemisphere arrays. So maybe
this content. Yeah, we are following your suggestion, and the bishop, I don't know if he is connected, but so I show you the simulation that we did with CTA, but we want to add also LHASO, and so bishop is here, can say something, but I think it's very important. It
could be quite interesting if okay.
Can I ask another question, or about localization? I guess I'm particularly interested in black hole mergers and stuff going near AGN. But it sounded like what you said, the prospects, even with large networks, we're not going to do much better than 1 degree from the gravitational side. Is that true in terms of source localization, just from gravitational waves? And then for black hole mergers, you might not necessarily expect an electromagnetic signature. It'll be much harder to figure it out. So if you have a 1 degree error box and you're going out to redshift 1 or 3 or something, you'll have a huge amount of confusion and possible counterparts if it's not a very strong transient. Is that going to be a limit to understanding black hole mergers and connecting them possibly to AGNs? How would you prove the association? Like, I like the possibility of doing it in an accretion disk. That's a great environment. And you see the IMF could be skewed towards the centers of galaxies, so that's a great location. But how would you prove that if your localization is 1 degree? Is it possible to do better than that?
So I show you the localization for BNS. For binary black hole, so what happened is that, so if you look at the future, so there you gain a lot using in the waveform higher order mode, and you gain more on the binary black hole that have more asymmetric on the mass. But the ones that are more closer, you can have a good sky localization. And you have to think that the ones that are more closer, you can have ET plus LIGO plus Cosmic Explorer. So you can go smaller than 1 square degree. So there are for sure some events that will be smaller than 1 square degree. In any case, if you have, I think, a high energy counterpart, if you remember the first very weak signal of Fermi in the first binary black hole, there having a temporal coincidence could be striking to say that. So there is fantastic. If you have an optical, I think still 1 degree is very good. No, if you it's true that you have a lot of contaminant, but for BNS we do this search also. Now, there are a lot of machine learning algorithm things, so it's possible also over 100 square degree. It's true that for binary black hole, you don't have a precise expectation on the optical counterpart, so it can be more difficult. But then you have also the fact that there you have to associate an AGN, so you have to look inside one square degree, what are the AGN that are inside? And so putting together all these things, I think is really not bad, the situation.
Yeah. There can be like 1 square degree, it can be 200 AGN if you go to optical magnitude R of 23.
Yeah. So yeah, it depends the distance, yeah. Because you have also the information on the distance and the volume. So at that point, you can reduce your number of AGN, taking into account the volume of the universe. Mm-hmm. In the future, so also the information on the distance, the precision on the distance will be better. So I think that using the volume, we can make this type of simulation to understand. But I think that is promising. I think it's not so bad, the situation.
Okay. All right. Thanks. Yeah.
Okay. Any other questions to Marika? All right. Well, if not, let's thank Marika for this very stimulating and wide-ranging talk. And I think we all wish success to this multi-message astrophysics. It's really fantastic developments.